Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Transylvania's very first creative intelligence event of the academic year. I am so pleased that you're joining us for this very special presentation. My name is Zoe Strecker, and I am an art professor here at Transy, as well as the director of the Creative Intelligence Program. I said this before, but please know that there is closed captioning available during this webinar. You just have to click it on, activate it there at the bottom of your screen. Also, know that we will have about 15 minutes or so for a question and answer session after the lecture. You're welcome to use that question box at the bottom of the screen also to type at any point during the presentation, and we'll save your questions, but the responses will happen at the end of the evening. Our campus theme for this year is justice, and the focus is on racial justice issues for people of color, especially Black and Indigenous Americans. I am immensely pleased and really honored for artist Wendy Red Star to launch our season tonight because her powerful art does the work of seeking justice. She works in an impressively broad range of forms, including sculpture, photography, video, fiber arts, and performance. And her work does tell stories. They're witty, provocative, unsettling, and I think you will see essential. Raised on the Apsaloga Reservation in Montana, Wendy Red Star's work is informed by her cultural heritage. An avid researcher of archives and historical narratives, Red Star seeks to incorporate and recast her research, offering new and unexpected perspectives on the past. She also works with an eye to the future. Earlier this month, the New York Times Magazine featured Red Star in an article about guest editing the current issue of Aperture Photography Magazine. I have it here. She curated a really intriguing and powerful collection of work by contemporary Indigenous artists with the hope, she said, of inspiring the next generation of Native artists. Red Star holds a BFA from Montana State University in Bozeman and an MFA in sculpture from the University of California, Los Angeles. She currently lives and works in Portland, Oregon. Please join me in welcoming Wendy Red Star.
Thank you, Zoe. That was so kind of you. And I'm just honored to be here with all of you. I know it's been a tough year, and I really look forward to these moments where we all can kind of gather and talk about art and the power of art. So just really want to thank Zoe for inviting me. And I didn't know I was the first, so another true honor to the Transylvania University Creative Intelligence Program. And I just love that creative intelligence. I think it's brilliant. So yes, thank you. And I'm going to go ahead and share my screen and start my presentation. All right. So I just took a road trip to care for my father. His name is Wallace Red Star, and he still resides along with much of my Red Star side on the Crow Indian Reservation in Montana. And so from Portland to Montana, it's about a 14-hour haul, but I really look forward to traveling to the reservation. And every time I enter into the reservation boundaries, I see this sign and immediately I feel like I'm coming home. And this sign actually has, we have a Crow tribal flag and we have an emblem. And so this sign has the Crow tribal emblem, which was created in the late 1960s. I'm going to talk about a project that I did when I was in undergrad. I went to undergrad at Montana State University, which was a few hours away from the Crow Reservation. And the reason why I like to show this, I don't know if we have any students who are in undergrad, but I love to show this because it's a really important work, which I consider kind of the root of my art practice and the way that I continue to make work. So what you're seeing right here on the screen is the state of Montana. And you're seeing the territories of tribal nations before there was the state of Montana, and then afterwards, the current federally recognized reservations, which there are seven located in Montana. And so the Crow Reservation is in located at the bottom, right next to the Wyoming border. And we're also adjacent to the Cheyenne Reservation. And in yellow, that is showing the territory that we occupied before contact. And we also occupied lands in Wyoming as well. And so when I went to Montana State University, I was an art major. I think I started first in graphic design and then switched over my sophomore year to sculpture. But in that time, I also was very interested in taking Native American studies. I didn't even know what that meant. And so when I took some of the first classes, we talked about US policies with Native communities, Native nations in the US. And that got me really interested in learning more about my community and our direct relationship with the US government. And beyond that, just Crow history in general. So growing up on the Crow Reservation, I never really questioned anything because it was just normal. So I never questioned, I didn't even have a thought of why I lived on a reservation, to just put that out there. And so it wasn't until I took these Native Studies classes that I was learning about how the reservations were formed and that certain words that I would hear my dad talking about, because he was a rancher and he worked with a lot of our allotments, our family's allotments, which was the thing that also happened to Native people on reservations. So anyways, when I started digging into Crow history, I found this guy, and his name is Sits in the Middle of the Land. And he was one of our primary chiefs around the 1800s, mid 1800s. And he was responsible for telling the US government where Crow territory was. And he used this beautiful metaphor of the way that Crows set up our teepees. And he said, "My home is where my teepee sits." And the way that Crows set up our teepees is we use four foundation poles, and then we set the rest of the poles up on those foundation poles and then the hide covering. And so what he did, I'm gonna go back to this map here, is he set those four foundation poles up on four major points in which we migrated throughout the season. And then he said, "My home is where my teepee sits," and that encompassed 38.5 million acres. And he told this to the US government at the Fort Laramie Treaty in the 1850s. And that really struck me. I sort of sat with that and sat with that sort of idea of our teepee as our home, and our home being this 38.5 million acres. And when I took a closer look, I realized where I was going to school in Bozeman was within Crow territory. And so I got really excited about that. And I told my dad, like, "I want to do a project. I want to honor our ancestors and the territory," which I never knew, you know, going to Bozeman, that was Crow country originally. And I also wanted to let the Bozeman community know that they were on Crow lands. And so I told my dad, "I'd like to illustrate that by harvesting some lodgepoles from the mountains on the reservations and then taking those and setting them up on campus." And so this was the first iteration. And with this one, I wanted to show exactly how you set up a Crow teepee. So there's the four foundation poles, which is the metaphor that sits in the middle of the land use, then the rest of the poles, and then the final teepee with the cover. And aesthetically, Crows are looking for really long, slender poles. And the hope is that the poles would make an hourglass design or sort of an inverted teepee on top of a teepee. And that is a look that we are sort of looking for. And you'll notice, like with Lakota, they use three poles to set up their teepee, and they don't have as long of poles. And each tribal nation that uses a teepee constructs it a little bit differently. And so with that, then I just sort of drove around campus with my lodgepoles and sort of scouted different territories in which I, these teepee structures. And then I would just observe. I'd watch for a few days and see what sort of interaction the public would do. And so sometimes they would walk around, sometimes they would walk through, and then I would move on to another area. And this particular piece, I set up right across from a co-ed dorm. This is that really tall building in the back. And I just wanted to say that setting these up, I usually had to wrangle a few people, friends, or sometimes my mom would come up and help me set them up. And it was pretty much an all day venture to set these up. And so with this particular one, I set it up and then I went home. And then the next day I came and they were all knocked down. And I thought, well, perhaps it was the wind. And so I set them up, took all day, went home, came back, and they were knocked down again. And I thought, well, I don't think this is the wind anymore. And I decided I would just make this fortress teepee and set up all the poles on one structure. And it took me all day. And I thought, like, no one's going to be able to knock these down. It's going to be too much of a hassle. Came back and knocked down again. So then I decided I would just take this operation and install them on the football field on the 50-yard line. And reflecting back on this piece, I really think about this piece of property is a prime real estate for America, the football field and the football stadium. And I thought this was a great place to really kind of stake that this is Crow territory. And to articulate the reason why I consider this a foundational piece and the way that I continue to make work is it started with the image of sits in the middle of the land, and then digging into him and his history, and then finding that quote, that very important quote that really affected the way that I have experienced being an Upsaluga. This is a show that I had at the Q Foundation in New York City, I believe in 2017. And we have an event that happens on our reservation every third week of August called Crow Fair. And it originally started in 1904 by the US government as a way to assimilate crows into farming culture. And so what they decided they would do is they would create this fair, and they called it Crow Fair, and they modeled it after the Midwest fairs in hopes that crows would bring their livestock and their produce, and then there would be prizes and things like that, competition, and that the crows would then sort of get into this annual event. And knowing that crows might not be so excited about doing that, because we were not a farming people, they decided to lift up some of the restrictions that all crows and all native people were going through at the time, which is anything cultural was restricted. And so by lifting some of those restrictions, the crows then added to this fair a parade in which we wear our finest regalia, and then we paraded around the encampment of Crow Fair. So everybody, when they attend Crow Fair, sets up a camp, a family camp. And so every morning there is this parade that happens. Crow Fair also has a powwow, which is dancing. There's actually a rodeo. And then there's also every year sort of these random things that are, I think, are sort of offshoots of this sort of fair concept. So what I decided to do is I wanted to focus on the parade aspect of Crow Fair and then sort of mine different archives, starting with my own images of Crow Fair and then my family's images, and then looking into archives such as the National Anthropological Archives, historical societies in Montana, any archive that would have images of Crow people and hopefully Crow Fair. And so then what I did with all of those images is I printed them out and cut each of the figures out individually and decided to do a timeline that articulated the different decades of Crow Fair. I also wanted to point out Unvaxbilia is what we call crow fair, and it literally translates to where they make the noise. And that's sort of perfect because that's what crow fair is. There's a bunch of sounds, and it's open not just to crows, it's open to the public at large. So sometimes we get up to 50,000 people that will attend from all over the world. So I'm just going to show a tiny little video, a section of a video of the timeline. So this is starting in 2016 is when I started the timeline. And then basically these are just different parade goers, people getting ready for the parade. And on the wall, I wrote directly if I knew individuals' names. I even wrote down the horses' names. If there was a certain activity that was happening, I would write down what that activity was, in any sort of articles of clothing of interest, any sort of facts, I would try to write down on the wall. So when you're walking through this timeline, you can sort of pause and you can read people's names. I'm gonna pause right here. This woman, first of all, here's my daughter, Beatrice Red Star Fletcher at age 5. And then there is this woman here, her name's Winona Plenty Hoops. And the reason why I wanted to include her in this image is because she's dressed a certain way, which we call in sort of old style way. And she is the last of this generation, which would be my grandma's generation, to dress the style in which they make their own dresses. They wear these leather high top moccasins that they make, and leather belts. And they always have a scarf either on their head or around their neck. And growing up, I used to see women and men dress in the old style as well, but now I don't, when I go back home, no one dresses this way. So I thought it was so important to include her, but she also pops up later on in the timeline in the 1910s. Let's see if I can get it going here, as a small child. So that was sort of fun to see that happening. This is actually my grandmother in the 1920s. And let's see if I can catch her. This is 1910, we're in. We're getting around the corner here. So, this is Winona here. It's a little blurry. She's amongst her relatives and several generations, and this would be 1910. So it was really kind of fun then to sort of immerse myself in this experience of this timeline that wraps around this gallery space, and I could sort of crisscross back and forth and point out people who show up multiple times in the timeline, or also different regalia or things like that were similar in different portions of the timeline. Here's a small little sample of, I think this is the 1920s here. And this is in the 80s, moving into the 70s and the 60s. So the smaller images that you see there are actually slides that my father took. And then I took those slides and selected different parade riders. The other thing to note about this timeline is that what was really striking to me is like about half of it is in color and the other half is in black and white. And all the images that are in color are pretty much taken by crows taking photos of crows. And then the black and white are mostly taken by white men, white male photographers, except for one man named Richard Thrussell, who was half Cree and half Scottish. And then I started the timeline with my daughter because she's the next generation to hopefully continue this tradition of parading Crow Fair. So this is what Crow Fair actually looks like. So this is the my family's camp. It's known as the Old Man Eagle Camp, which is my grandfather's Crow name. And so every family basically has a camp, and you're looking at the teepees in which we sleep in, and then also sort of the kitchen where everybody kind of hangs out and gossips. You might have noticed a lot of the dresses that the women were wearing look like they had polka dots on them, and those are actually elk-tooth dresses, and the white polka dot things are the two eye teeth of an elk. And what that is basically stating or symbolizing is the hunting abilities of the men in the family, or the trading abilities, because there were only two eye teeth per elk, and typically an elk tooth dress would have about 500 teeth, or a good one, I would say, would have about 500 teeth. And nowadays, most of the teeth, I would say a majority of the teeth, are all synthetic teeth made out of resin, but they still hold that like symbolism. This is my daughter Beatrice just after the parade. And this is my family participating in the parade float. Here we are in action. And here's just a video to just sort of show you everything in motion. So I do want to note that we didn't have Crow Fair this year because of the pandemic. So that's the first time in my lifetime that we have not had Crow Fair. And Crow Fair to me has felt like it's been around forever, even further back from 1904, because my grandfather was born in 1907 and my grandma 1920, my dad in 1941, and everyone has always participated in Crow Fair. This next work I want to talk about happened at the Portland Art Museum. I had a solo show in 2014, and I titled it Medicine Crow and the 1880 Crow Peace Delegation. And this project stemmed from these two images of Medicine Crow, who was a visionary chief of my tribe. And I have an uncanny relationship with these two images in particular. Ever since I left the reservation, I've run into these images in some way or another. This is some of the encounters that I've had, like going through the airport. I've on the East Coast, I saw Medicine Crow on this book called Indian Spirit. And then when I was in graduate school, the closest grocery store to get to, I went to graduate school at UCLA, was Whole Foods. And I would go in there just to get Honest Tea, because Medicine Crow was on Honest Tea. And every time I would see him before I did the show, I was very comforted. And actually, I'll say that I'm still kind of comforted anytime I see an image of any tribal member. And so I was sort of comforted to have this Honest Tea, and I'd stick it in my studio and I'd look over and I'd like, there's Medicine Crow. And so it wasn't until I was offered the solo exhibition that I started to think about those two images, because there was a lot of talk about cultural appropriation, especially regarding the use of Native images and Native designs. And I started asking myself, well, how has this directly sort of hit my community? And immediately I thought about Medicine Crow and the power of that image of him, those two images, and how commercial businesses have been using that image. I've seen artists, if you Google his name, you'll notice that there are drawings of Medicine Crow and paintings of Medicine Crows. I've seen him on a mural. And I know, like, you're seeing Barack Obama here. that's because Medicine Crow has a descendant named Joseph Medicine Crow. And he was an anthropologist and a historian, and Barack Obama's giving him a medal. So after sort of like looking, kind of briefly digging into it, then I asked myself, wait a minute, I don't even know what happened. What happened when he sat down to take that photo? I know nothing about that. I know just from being a tribal member who he is, but I didn't know beyond what was happening. And so it was with that I learned that there are delegation portraits, and you can Google Native American delegations and you'll see tons of Native nations who have participated in getting these portraits because they were doing business with the US government and had traveled to Washington, DC to sit with a president. And so this particular delegation happened in 1880, and the photographs were taken by a photographer named C.M. Bell, Charles Milton Bell, who was the chief photographer for the Bureau of Ethnology. So these photos were being held in the Bureau of Ethnology. And at that time, I believe they were really used as a way to sort of type different Native nations. So they photographed this delegation of six Crow chiefs, and that was a type. This is what Apsaloga people are supposed to look like, because that was sort of the thinking of the time. And so the reason why they traveled to Washington, DC, all the way from Crow Country in Montana, was because the US government was trying to put a train through a large tract of our hunting territory. And so they were going there to fight that, negotiate that. And so now when I look at any of these delegation portraits, all I really see is resilient leaders really fighting on behalf of their Native communities to retain their land holdings, their culture, their language. So that's what I see now when I see that image. And so basically, this opened up a whole new world. It wasn't just Medicine Crow. Now I had five other chiefs to research, and also this trip to look into. And the amazing thing about this particular delegation trip, so the Crow Nation has actually participated in several delegation trips. There was the first one was in 1873, and this was the second trip. The amazing thing about this delegation trip was there's a lot of records and a lot of accounts of this particular trip, including these amazing drawings by Medicine Crow himself from memory of his experience in Washington, DC. And so this is a drawing that Medicine Crow did of the Capitol. Here are several different types of boats. Three different types of trains. And then the other thing that I was interested in is really like the agency of these chiefs and what they were trying to state as Apsaloga people through their clothing. And what they were trying to state was how they became chiefs. And it wasn't an easy feat. There were four things that need to be witnessed in order to become a chief. And that was to be the first in battle, to touch an enemy warrior, taking a weapon from an enemy in hand-to-hand combat, stealing a horse from within an enemy camp, and leading a successful war party. And there are certain elements that you could wear then that would state like that you stole a horse, or that you were the first in battle to touch an enemy, or that you captured a weapon. So for instance, these ermine represent that Old Crow, this is a picture of Old Crow, represent that he was able to capture a weapon. And the coup feather represents, that he led a successful war party. And so all these different elements articulated different sort of honors and coups that they attained. And all of these honors needed to be witnessed. And so then with that, I took these delegation portraits, which all of the chiefs had individual portraits, just like the two Medicine Crow photos that I initially sparked my interest. And I started outlining the outfits and sort of pointing to the different materials. And then beyond that, I also started to write down different things that I was learning about each of these men. For instance, in the census records, Medicine Crow would have been about 50 years, I mean, Old Crow, sorry, would have been about 50 years old during this delegation trip. And he was actually the oldest member on that particular delegation. Another thing, if I could find their name written in Apsaluga, which the Apsaluga language was never, initially wasn't a written language. It was turned into a written language in the 70s. I tried to include that also. And then from there, I just started learning so much about each of these men. A lot of growing up, I've heard the names of these men. So this is Pretty Eagle. And what I learned from researching Pretty Eagle was that when he died, his body was actually stolen from its gravesite along with several other tribal members. And then his body was sold and it ended up in the Natural History Museum or the American Museum of Natural History in New York City for about 72 years. And then in the 90s, the tribe was actually able to get his remains back. And there's a place on our reservation called Pretty Eagle Point that has this bronze teepee structure. And he is buried there. And I knew about Pretty Eagle Point. I didn't know that it was created because of this story of his remains being stolen and sold and then brought back. So that was really kind of incredible to uncover that information. This is Tubelly. And Tubelly is, there's actually two subgroups. There's the River Crow and the Mountain Crow. And most of the rest of the delegation are all Mountain Crow. And Tubelly is actually the only River Crow representative. And you can sort of tell even in like the style of dress where all the other men are wearing war shirts. Tubelly is wearing a beautiful otter fur trimmed leather floral beaded jacket. And the Portland Art Museum has a Native American collection and they have some crow objects. And in looking through their crow objects, they actually have this really beautiful, amazing example of one of these jackets minus the fur otter trim. And so I wanted to include that in the exhibition because if these images were in color, this jacket is a great example of the vibrancy that you would see if only there was color technology. This is Plenty Coup, and he was the last primary chief of our tribe, and he died in the 1930s. And I have a personal connection with Plenty Coup because right before he died, he allotted his land to the state of Montana to turn into a state park. And it's called Chief Plenty State Park. And it's on the reservation. And I actually ran that for about a year. And it holds his log cabin, his gravesite, along with his wife and his adopted daughter. There's also a visitor center that has a lot of his personal artifacts, including other tribal members' artifacts and some walking trails. And so when I was doing research for this project, they were in Washington, D.C. for 2 months. And so within that time period, they also occupied this delegation with sort of special trips and different things to do. And so they took this delegation to visit Mount Vernon, which is Washington's estate. And Plenty Coup was so impressed by Mount Vernon that he got in his mind that he would like to create a miniature Mount Vernon on our reservation. And so that's what Chief Plenty Coup State Park is. It's basically inspired by Washington's estate. And the other thing that I learned was that it wasn't images. The whole time I've been sort of followed by those two images wherever I go. There were a few other positions that were included. And these images are housed at the National Anthropological Archives. So, and this image, there's a few things I always like to point out. The fact that Medicine Crow is wearing hair extensions, and you can actually see I've circled around them. They're pooled on the ground here. And Crow men, most of them in this delegation were wearing these hair extensions. Long hair equals power. And these hair extensions are woven together from people who, there's a Crow custom where when someone dies, a lot of times their close family members will cut their hair very short. And so a lot of these hair extensions are made from the people's and mourning's hair and then are weaved together using a sticky pine pitch and then attached to a sort of a leather beaded band and then attached to the base of the head. He's also wearing this hair bow, which is actually broken. So it's supposed to look like this. And the other things I like to point out is that the different hairstyles, especially in contrast with Two-Belly, all the Mountain Crow are wearing this very popular pompadour hairstyle where they sort of cut their bangs short and then stiffen them with white clay to keep them upright. So I wanted to talk about a little bit about those Medicine Crow drawings that I showed earlier. Those were actually, there's a clerk named Charles H. Barstow, and he worked for the government agent on the reservation. And in his office, he had this practice anytime a Crow, or he also worked on some other reservations, would come into his office and they were waiting to do business, he would supply them with paper and pencil and then ask them to draw certain experiences that they had. And these drawings have a very amazing story. I won't get into it, but they were saved and they're now located at Montana State University in Billings in their collection. And so he asked Medicine Crow when they returned from their 2-month trip to DC to draw from memory his entire experience. And one of those experiences was a trip to see a circus. And I believe it's like one of the first circuses in the United States. And so there are these amazing drawings of these circus animals. And the writing is actually Barstow's writing, but many of these animals don't exist in Crow country. So Medicine Crow also came up with names for these animals. And so the peacock, its wonder tail comes from above. You've got the giraffe as a spotted mule. I love the fact that they're showing catfish at the circus. And so we have catfish. And this camel, which he called an elk with a big back on him. And I became like very invested in these circus drawings because they're incredible. But I really, I was like, I need to make these tangible for myself. I can't just have them exist as these flat pieces that I'm looking at digitally. And there happened to be an advertisement on social media where you could take children's drawings and then turn them into this company and they would make them into soft toys. So I decided, why don't I just give that a try? And so I took the elk with a big back on him and sent it over, and this is what came back. And then I just got really into that and decided, why don't I keep trying this? And so I took the big snake with legs. And this was like a really fun process because I had no idea what sort of edits they were gonna make and things that they were gonna keep. And so it was a surprise for me every time they would be shipped back to me. And so we have mountain lions, so we call it kind of a mountain lion for the lion. The dog and man, or man dog for monkey. And this one is some great insight. I just from the trains to the Capitol, all of that was just incredible, all from memory. Even like at the top corner here, he's got the river marked. I just really love the way of sort of positioning himself. It's so interesting. But the fact that he gave the zebra dots instead of stripes, you could tell like a little loss of memory on that one. So another important aspect of this exhibition was actually out of circumstances. I started a wonderful collaboration with my daughter. She was 7 at the time. And we then, from this exhibition, started this great collaboration that lasted until she was about 11 years old. She's since retired herself, but and it started with this exhibition in which I was at that point in my life working a full-time job and also doing my art career and sort of cramming every opportunity that I had time-wise to make work. And I needed like about one more thing to kind of like round out the show. And so I had several Xerox copies of all of these delegation portraits that I was marking on. And she came up to me one night after work and wanted to play. And I said, you know, I've got to finish this, but here's a stack of these Xeroxes. I didn't even think about it. I said, you can play with them. I'm not using them. And then she came back with this amazing drawing of Medicine Crow. And that's when it clicked. I was like, that's it. It's really is, this work that I'm doing is for the next generation, a platform for them to then continue to take on and mold and utilize. And so I asked her if she would be interested in like doing more of these drawings, and she said yes. And so I created this little studio for her, and she went to town, and she did believe about 20 of these drawings. And on the way to the exhibition opening, she asked if she could talk about her work. And I wasn't expecting that. And so I said, of course you can talk about your work. So here she is talking about her work. And she also talked about the circus animals. She has this amazing ability of public speaking. So that was something that I didn't know until she spoke about her work. And also the other thing that I realized is that I had put this sort of limitation or as a parent, that like, this is, you know, there's the separation of parent and then there's this artist. And I realized with this exhibition that I didn't have to do that, like, and that we could form a collaboration and she could learn about her culture this way as well. And like, there didn't need to be the separation. And so with that, the first thing we did, I'm gonna cruise over this, is we invited her class to come, and then she gave a whole tour of the exhibition to her class. And then from there, I decided any opportunity that I would get, I would ask her if she was interested in doing something with me. And if she was, then I would communicate that to whatever institution we were working with. And it sort of went like that. So we participated in a group show at the Portland Art Museum in 2016 called Contemporary Native Photographers and Edward S. Curtis Legacy. And we created 4 portraits called Absaliga Feminist, because Edward Curtis, who is a historical photographer and photographed a project called The Vanishing Race, where he was trying to photograph as many different Native nations before we all went extinct. Thankfully, we didn't go extinct, but he did photograph the Absaliga community in the early 1900s. And what I was really missing from his portfolio of Absaliga images was women, more women. And in particular, because we are a matrilineal society, and I really wanted to showcase that, plus color technology and the vibrancy of our outfits. Giving a little tour of our work on exhibit there. And she also did a tour for her class, which was like the next year. We participated in an artist residency together at the Denver Art Museum. And then she just said she wanted to make a tour just specifically for children. So we set her up with her own little ID and then let her run loose in the museum. And she selected different art objects that she wanted to talk about. And we gave her a little education on each of those objects. And then she created three 30-minute tours of the Native American galleries and the Western art galleries. And she got so invested in this idea of being a tour guide that she wanted a tour guide outfit. So she drew me a little drawing of what that should look like. And then I sewed that up for her. And here she is in action. It's an interesting little side note here with the Denver Art Museum. They hired through Works Progress Administration in the 50s and all the way into the 70s, they hired artists from the Denver community to come in and draw all the objects in the Native American collection and the African collection on catalog cards for each object. And those were never to be seen by the public. And the only reason why I saw them is because the Denver Art Museum has such an amazing collection of Kroll objects that I asked to see and have images of all the objects, and all of a sudden these beautiful watercolor drawings started to come up. And so what you're looking at in the background of my father and my daughter is one of these watercolor drawings of a Kroll wedding blanket. And then on the back of this catalog card, the original ones, were all the information about that object, when it came into the collection, how much they bought it for, and what it was. And so I asked the Denver Art Museum if I could take, you know, have copies of these. And then I wanted to pair them with parade riders and give you the context of like how we actually use those objects. Because when you go into a museum that has a Native gallery or pretty much any cultural items, that are displayed sort of in as an art object, you're not getting really what the function is for what these objects are and how they're utilized by their communities. So this is a wedding blanket. And so my daughter has one here that she's parading with. This is actually a beaded floral belt that I was able to find this young man using one as a horse collar. Crow men wear cuffs, and so he's wearing a cuff here, and there's an example of one in the Denver Art Museum collection. This is a beaded saddlebag, and so here is one being utilized. And then I just want to talk about two more of our collaborative projects. We were invited to the Tang Teaching Museum, and for this particular experience or project, I decided I would be an apprentice and learn how to make this body of work called The Four Seasons that I made in 2006. And basically I made this work after having experienced the Natural History Museum in Los Angeles. I went there to see if they had any Kroll objects, and they did. But what happened was I actually went into that institution, and you had to walk through this dinosaur exhibit and then you entered into the Native galleries. And I it was the first time that I had actually looked at the experience of an institution and how everyone who went into that institution was set up to think that Native cultures were extinct, just by like having us go through the dinosaur exhibit and then watching everybody observe the Native objects, including the Upsaloga objects, and me having my entire outfit those similar objects with me and me being an Obisalaga person. So I decided I wanted to create that experience by creating these full dioramas and then placing myself within them. So I decided Bea would create her own seasons. And so I showed her, you know, how to gather all the materials, and then we set up a diorama in the museum. This is towards the end of the day. And then this time we had actually museum goers model within the diorama, and then Beatrice photographed them. So she had the agency, and then they had the experience of being on display. And this was our final collaborative project, where she gave a tour at the Pulitzer in St. Louis of some of their exhibits. This is the Ruth Asawa exhibit. And there she is in action. And I'm going to end there, just on our collaboration. She's now retired. but I learned so much by working with her, and I look forward to seeing her thoughts on our practice, our collaborative practice, once she gets older. But I'll go ahead and stop there, and I'm happy to answer any questions from the audience.
Still muted. Thank you so much, Wendy. What an amazing presentation. A good timing on the question. I want to read one to you. Okay. There are actually two. And this is fantastic because this is a former student of mine who is now out in the world making art of her own and has recently collaborated with one of our professors here on a book about migrants. So that's fantastic. So she writes, this is Annalisa, not so much a question, but the way you have encouraged your daughter to cultivate her art, her culture, her public speaking skills, and really letting her dive into that on her own terms is incredibly inspiring and so, so, so important. Children really have so much creativity and power. We just have to give them the tools to use that voice. That's awesome, she says.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. You know, and the way that it happened was really great too, because it really kind of happened out of like a happy accident. And then it was pretty organic moving forward. It really was like, you know, hey, do you want to do something at the Tacoma Art Museum? Sure. You know, and then like we'd come up with something together. It was an interesting space, me being the adult and sort of like handling all the logistics of trying to make this very successful space for her, where she didn't have to be threatened or stressed out by all the things that the adults are. And then me sort of just kind of fostering that for her. And the fact that we hit this very sweet moment where originally it was me asking for institutions if, hey, can I collaborate with my child? And them sort of being like, that sounds really cute. And then really getting into it. And then as the years went, institutions were contacting us, like the Tang and the Pulitzer, and me being like, this is great. Like, we can keep going. And then her being like, that was fun. I'm going to retire now. I'm going to retire, and I really want to get into like my life and my school and all of that stuff. And they grow and they change so quickly. So that was such a valuable like lesson for me to learn as an adult, who like once something's successful, you kind of just want to stay there and be comfortable.
Yeah, that's interesting, because one of the next questions, Kurt Gutty, one of the art professors here, asked, can you talk a bit about how your daughter decided to retire and what your process to support her decision? As a valued collaborator of yours, it must have been doubly challenging to see that part of your own practice ending.
You know, to tell you the truth, it was a lot to kind of juggle, because you are dealing with somebody who like criticism and things like that. Like I, you know, shilled her, not that we, I don't think ever got anything, but like I was sort of shielding all of those sort of things. And then also she was really great professionally, but as a child, they're still children. And so like, you know, now we're actually working, you know, so like, we got to do this for a little bit. This is the thing. So we started when she was 7, and you would not believe, I don't know how many of you out there have experience with your own children, but there was like a switch between 8 and 9 where she became very kind of self-conscious. And it made me so sad because I realized all of us have gone through that, and I was able to witness that. So those drawings, those amazing drawings that she did, when she saw those, because that show traveled for 2 years, she's like, I don't like these. She went from being so proud of them to like sort of almost a little bit embarrassed of them. And that was something that I was like, wow, like this is just like human development. And like, I forgot about that. And I had to like connect with a part of me. So part of her retirement was just like her growing up and like finding her own independence and allowing her to do that. And I have no doubt that we'll probably do something again at some point. I look forward to it.
So do we. here's a great question from one of my students, Sonda. She asks, what advice do you have for other artists who feel like their culturally specific work is not understood or appreciated by society or their superiors?
Yeah, I would say you can't look to the outside, even though that's so hard. And I think if you do that, then you're going to be blocked or stunted. And also you have to think, and also too, is this a colonial? Am I setting myself in this colonial framework? You know, because we've all grown up in a colonial system. And so anything outside of that is not going to fit in. And so by saying it doesn't fit in, that's really that's a colonial view. And I catch myself doing that all the time. But I realize, you know, especially when working with all this historic images and objects and things like that, and actually seeing all these white photographers photograph my community and the anthropologists that write about our community, and sort of the being conflicted about that, I'm happy that it is all there, that there's someone like me and sounds like someone like you as well to sort of kind of pick up the rest of that story, the missing part of that story. So what you do, what you're doing and the things that you're thinking about are so important. And so just continue going forward. And I've actually found this space where I think it's kind of cool not to fit in. And that's kind of, I think you're doing something right if you're not fitting in. So just keep doing what you're doing.
This is a question that came up much earlier during your presentation, saving it for now. Have you seen many other changes and modifications to the regalia or dresses like the elk teeth that have happened throughout the years? Do you ever feel modernity is too imposing on aesthetic traditions? How do you keep the symbolism alive, making sure future generations don't forget?
No, I think that's the stuff I live for. I just love it. And that sort of Native people have always been doing that. They're not siloed. They're not living. They're not like living in a vacuum. And those are things that when I enter into a collection, like I've been humbled so greatly with sort of preconceived notions every time. And so like, for instance, there's an earlier delegation, 1873, and there's 11 Crow members, including their wives, and they're all sitting there and their moccasins, they're not wearing Upsaliga moccasins, they're wearing Cheyenne or Lakota moccasins. And those are historically where they didn't really like us. It's like, wait a minute, like that blew my mind. So just like all of that stuff, I think you just have to be completely open to history. And then also, I think I love the ingenuity of like seeing like, oh, we don't have access to the elk anymore, but we're still going to figure out how to make elk teeth, and it's still going to, you know, now instead of the men, it's me finding the best like fake elk teeth and trying to get as many as possible, you know? So it's like, I'm still representing, you know? So to me, I think that's all part of the story, and it's a really rich story. And so it's better to have those sort of interesting nuances.
So a segue into this question about that particular story, Kermena Todorova asks, can you say more about the American government forbidding Crow people from showcasing their culture at the fair? How did the government go about it? How long did that prohibition last? Do you think it had any impact on the Crow people, or were they able to work around it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think it happened to all Native people around the turn of the century. And I think, gosh, I don't want to put out the dates, but there were different sort of different acts, like there's like the Religious Freedom Act. And I think if that even happened, I don't want to misstate. I think like in the 60s or something like that. So it wasn't even that long ago where they were banning any sort of like the Sundance. I think the Sundance for us came back in the 40s. So just things like that, the government was putting a stop to. And it all stems from just trying to eradicate Native people from the get-go. And some of that eradication came from the boarding schools, which I think the first one was the Carlisle boarding school by this guy named Pratt. And he's the one who coined the phrase, kill the Indian, but save the man. And his whole idea was like, cut off all the Native people's hair, bring all the children in, cut all their hair off. They can't speak any of their language. And then we'll educate them and we'll Christianize them. And then basically we've killed the Indian, but we've saved the man. And so that had a horrible effect because you lost a lot of the languages and they were severely abused for speaking it. So when they had children, the last thing they were going to do to their child was teach them the language, because then they would suffer the abuse. So yeah, it just had a whole ripple effect. But I will say I love the subversion and the, you know, ways in which the culture is so resilient and strong. And that's why that timeline, when I finished the timeline and I stepped back and I looked at the earliest photos in 1904, and then I looked at 2016 and realized we're still doing it. We still have it. And they didn't kill it out of us. And so that's what I love, the resiliency and the way like those delegation photos represent us fighting. And so we still have been fighting. So that's what I'm finding most, is that, wow, we're still going. Still doing it.
One of our art students, Allie Frederick, asked, what audiences do you want to reach with your artwork in the future that you do not think you're reaching now, that you did not think you're reaching now?
I say just you know, for me, it really is everybody in the future generation. And this is how I speak the loudest. I'm terrible at writing. I think I do a decent job at speaking, but the best way that I can get my messages across, my research across, is visually, and I speak the loudest there and the most confident. And so I feel that my work is really about the human experience and humanity, and that's how I'm connecting to everybody, even if they're not Upsaliga. They might relate to something that I put in there that's quirky, or the just sort of different aspects that history works in such interesting ways, and it's so relatable and it's very grounding. And so, yeah, I guess I would hope it would be future generations, because that it would continue to resonate for them.
Interesting, tonight, even before we started your presentation, you taught me how to say Upsaluga, that was the correct term. And Hyundai Ozkin is asking about, she said, I was curious about how you define yourself in your artwork. Indigenous, Native, Native American, something else. Naming is always about power, and it is very contested. So I'd love to hear your views.
Yeah, that has changed actually quite a bit for me. So growing up on the reservation, everyone said Indian, Indian, not Indian, Indin. And so I was so used to that. And then I went to undergrad and started taking Native American studies classes. And when I felt very self-conscious to say Indian, because all, the academic community was saying Native American. And then I went to graduate school. And now when I'm sort of universally speaking, I say Native. I just say Native. Indigenous is fine. But yeah, those things constantly change. And I am very interested now, where I am in my life right now, of saying Upsalugat, because there's a specificity there. And I am not Lakota, I'm not Cheyenne, I'm not Tlingit. And so we speak, every one of the different Native nations speaks their own language. All of our outfits are different. We have different patterns. We have different colors. There's seven colors that the Upsaluga use that are different from the Lakota or the Kiowa. And so to me, specificity is so important right now for where I am. And so I prefer Upsaluga. And crow, the word crow is actually a mistranslation. So the Upsaluga, the literal translation of that word means children of the large-beaked bird, and it's a bird that is extinct. And some translator, I don't know, maybe an Upsaluga person was like, it's like a like that. Maybe there was a crow there, and now we're crows. So that even the crow is a mistranslation.
We are, it's a little after 8 already, so I don't want to keep you much longer. One of my students, Ryan Shepherd, is asking about this, the shift from sculpture to photography. And I think that is an interesting question because of your editing of the aperture issue this fall, which is a fantastic, I really do highly recommend anyone looking at it, not only because of Wendy Red Star's work, but because of all of the Indigenous artists from all over. They're really diverse and they're explored in fascinating ways. But anyhow, photography, not your original training, but yet something you've gravitated toward in your archival work, but also now has become an important feature of your own work, and I guess Beatrice's also. So yeah, talk a little bit about that shift to the other medium.
Sort of it's complex, but I will say that I think I've always had a fascination towards images. And I think what draws me to the image is the story. So for example, sits in the middle of the land and pulling out that story. And like when I look at that image of him, that's what I remember, that he used that metaphor. And so I think in undergrad, it's so different. That was like a long time ago, but we had to choose majors. And so I chose sculpture because at that time, that was the least conservative major that I felt like I could get away with the most stuff. Like if I wanted to paint, I could still paint. Or if I thought I could still do almost all the mediums if I selected sculpture. And then when I went to graduate school at UCLA, they housed all of the grad students in one building where our studios were. And that was amazing to actually walk around and see like a photography major and a new genres major and like interdisciplinary major. And from there, I was like really fascinated with the weird world of photography majors. Some of them were so particular, and they would wear white gloves and vacuum their studio. And I was like, what is this? And some, I had one who like ate Cheetos and like cut up her photos and stepped all over them. And I just really liked how tactile, and sort of an object that she made of the photo. And it's some of it was out of convenience too, like being a poor grad student. And when I made the Four Seasons, I never thought of that really as a photograph. I thought of that more as a documentation of an installation, or maybe even a performative piece in which I would sit in for a while. And then I took photos of it and realized, wow, these photos are kind of great because they don't take up a lot of space and you can actually digitize them and they can live as files. But I feel incredibly grateful for the photo community and their embrace of me, because I don't have any classic training in photography. And actually, one of the editors of Aperture said something that was really great, kind of helpful for me. And he said, I'm very photo literate and I know so much about photos and archives and investigating, you know, photographers and things like that. So he feels like I'm very well suited in that regard. But yeah, I just am in love with photos and the stories that, and the power of photos and the stories that they contain. And to me, with my sculpture background, I still feel like they're sculptures to me still. And especially in the way that I work and I'll build things and or I'll make our outfits, that kind of thing. They still feel very sculptural to me. That was a long answer.
No, but it touched on many, many other things you've said. That was terrific. And I'm gonna sort of blend these last two questions into one, Justin McDonald and Leslie Rybovich. So one person was asking about the process of compiling all the photos from the timeline and whether that was like a laborious job and whether it was hard to track them all down. And Leslie is also asking about that working as a way of reaching into history, teaching and telling and having that relationship with the past through your work. So kind of two questions rolled into one there. And I think we'll end with this one. So thank you so much.
Yeah. So it was pretty straightforward. It was kind of fun to pull images from archives. So I was just sort of pirating all of these images and then printing them off. And the way that I work, there's nothing fancy to my setup. I am super impressed with some of my artist friends who have giant studios and assistants and things like that. Mine originally was my living room, and now I have a basement. And so it's pretty kind of straightforward. And so with that particular timeline, it really was about kind of just mining different archives digitally online that I had access to, and then printing them on photo paper. And then I just had these yellow envelopes, those big envelopes, and I'd put 1960, and I would just shove all the images that said 19 that were from that decade and the 2000s. And then from there, cut them out. And no, I loved it. Of course, my hand was cramped for quite a while, but there's something about, for me, that a real need for me to be very intimate with these images. And so cutting them out and like really kind of gave me a deeper sense of the individual or the truck or whatever, the personality of what was going on in that image. And then where I grew up, I actually went to school off the reservation, even though it was surrounded by the reservation in Hardin, Montana. And it was a mix of Crow kids and mixed kids like myself. My mom is white, and white rancher kids. And it was extremely racist. And so if you were a Native kid, you pretty much didn't have a chance. And so, I mean, even my parents were told that I would never go to college and I should just go to trade school. And I remember sitting in history class, and we never talked about Native history. We never talked about Crow history, even though we were surrounded by the reservation and most of the population going to that school was Crow. And I just remember I hated history. I thought it was so boring and I couldn't connect to it. And so it's just wild to me now to find this love and this enthusiasm for history. And I'm sort of feel like I'm actually not going to be an artist. I'm trying to turn into like the greatest history teacher ever. Like these are like my teaching aids. Because I was like, if I would have had a history teacher like myself, I would have just been so in love with history. And I guess what it is it's like, it's representing me, that Crow kid who wasn't given a chance by my white teachers, that I would go anywhere. And when I think about it, like if they would have shown me this history, our history, it's our history, it's U.S. history. The self-esteem of Native people, we would feel like we have a chance. And so that's why I'm addicted to the research and the history and how it relates to me and how I see it moving forward in the future. So thank you.
Thank you so much. I mean, that I feel that that is a real act of generosity that you're sharing all of this with, not just us tonight, but just everyone who gets the chance to interact with your work. Really moving, really powerful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, I wish we could see the audience, everyone. grateful for this evening. And I want to say to the students there out there watching that we have a very few spots left tomorrow to work more with Wendy Red Star and talk about this ongoing process of being a professional artist and following conventional or unconventional paths. I think you can guess which path she has chosen. And let me know, students, if you're interested, you want a spot, just email me and I'll send you the registration form and we will meet with Wendy tomorrow at 7, but I'll send you those details if you're interested. But once again, thank you so much, Wendy, and congratulations on a beautiful, fantastic body of work. And we're looking forward to the rest of your lifetime of amazing work. So
thank you, Zoe. I appreciate it. Take care, everyone. Have a good night. Bye-bye.
Good night, everyone.